What is the last planner system, the pull plan? In this video, I'm actually gonna take you to a screen recording of my computer and show you what a pull plan looks like and show you the theory and concepts behind it so that you can grasp it and also take it to your projects. So if you're into that, stay with us on this video. Welcome everybody out to this video. I'm going to take you through some content from our book and then also show you how to do a pull plan over here on our mirror board right here in front of your eyes. I think you're absolutely going to love it. So if you really want to know how to perform a pull plan in its fundamental parts and you want an example, then this is the video for you. Stay with us. Okay, everybody, so I'm super excited. I'm going to start with the book content first. This is going to be from the book Takt Planning in the Art of the Builder series, and I'm going to take you through that. Then I'm going to go through an example over here on the board, and I think you're going to love it. Absolutely fantastic content, so let's go. Okay, so where I'd like to start here is in the book starting on page number 73. The first thing I like to do is establish the conditions of satisfaction, meaning that if this goes well, then all of the stakeholders will be satisfied, meaning that they'll feel like this was worth their time and that it went well. So the first thing I like to do is to prepare the team by communicating the date of the pull plan, the location, the milestone that we're pulling to, the expectations for preparation, right? And sometimes what I like to do is ask the trade partners to fill out an actual template, an Excel template, so that they have their tags, their stickies, their activities, whatever you want to call them, with their duration, with their crew counts, ready to go. Meaning that I find that this is like a really good way to prepare the team so that they come to the pull plan in the right frame of mind. When we're there, we can actually gather the team and we can talk to them about where the pull plan is taking place, where the supplies are, the conditions of satisfaction. We can prepare everything and then do an overview. And the reason that I want to do that is to orient them the day of. And here's why I like to do that is because I want to give everybody, whether they've prepared here or not, I want to give them time at the beginning of the pull plan for about 15 to 30 minutes to finish all preparations and get fully back into the context. So that means they can read the drawings. That means they can go back through their activities. That means they can prepare stickies, whatever the case may be. We have at this point said, hey, this is what we're going to do. Here's some time to prepare. That then allows us to, again, and although we've already done it over here, again, establish the conditions of satisfaction and make sure that everybody knows what we're doing, which is super important to me. Now, when we start the actual pull plan, one of the first things that I want to do is describe the start and end milestones. Now, you might be like, wait a minute, they should already know this. Okay, repetition is key to learning. And when you mention the milestone, so here's the start milestone, you're going to have lots of questions from the trades. They're going to be like, hey, that should be clear, but let's make sure that we're 100% clear. Okay, concrete. It's done, reshores are out, floor swept, grid lines are refreshed and cleared, right? And then the same thing with the end milestone. What does ready for sheetrock mean? So then you can go through and say, well, it means inspections are done. We're only on level 2. We're not complete with the elevators and we're ready to install drywall, right? So now everybody, if they're paying attention, should know exactly what we're doing because you've explained the start and end milestones and everybody knows the conditions of satisfaction. Once we have established the milestones, one of the things that I really like to do, and this is basically logistics, this is getting everybody on the same page, is communicate the sticky format. Now, this is really important for me because it has to be done in this way in order for it to be successful. So first and foremost, the activity. That's common with all pull plans, but what I need you to do here is at the bottom, or actually I don't care where it is, but I need you to list the needs, or you can say predecessors, or you can say constraints. I would rather call them needs. I'm very protective of the word constraints, right? And what this is going to enable everybody to do, or the facilitator of the pull plan to do, is to say, hey, every trade partner, as we're working backwards, needs to basically identify two things that they need to have in order for them to have their activities done on time per the commitment. Another thing you'll do, obviously, everybody does this. Everybody knows this. Make sure that every trade knows what color they are for their tags, for their stickies, so that they can get started. One of the things that I really wanted to talk to you about is the rules. Everybody, when they do a pull plan, and I do mean everybody, and I don't care how used to this you are or not, everybody has a tinge of nervousness when they do their first pull plan. Pull plans are tough. Everybody has different opinions. It's just a difficult thing, right? So one of the things that I want to do is establish the rules. Meaning meaning say, hey, everybody's done pole planning before, but instead of us arguing halfway through, let's come up with the rules together. What are our guidelines? And you'll see some over here. You know, one person speaks at a time is common, right? No touching other people's stickies, whether it's in person or virtually. You know, and I could go through these one by one, but the bottom line is you're coming up with a collective way of doing things. Those are my two really key tricks. If you follow this sticky format, and if you get on the same page with how you're doing it, the pull plan should be fairly stress-free. And I know that's a big promise, but I do want to promise that it can be a remarkable experience. So let's go down here into the actual run the pull plan part of the meeting. This is what probably my favorite. First of all, the facilitator invites the company with the last activity to come up to the board, which would be this one. Now, I want to pause here for just a second and say, to me, it doesn't matter if you go forward then back or backwards and then forward. Let me explain the concept about pull planning. What we want to do is create the sequence that takes care of the job, but then we want to make sure that all of the things the trade partner needs are covered as well. Let me give you an analogy. Let's say that you got into a marriage, and in that marriage, it was like, hey, I want this, 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 and this from your spouse. That marriage wouldn't go very well. But if you're like, hey, honey, I need this, this, and this in a marriage, what do you need in the marriage? And let's co-partner. That's a marriage that will go pretty well. So basically, a pull plan is a marriage between what the job and the contractor needs and what the trade partner needs from a commitment standpoint and a support standpoint to get it done. Now, let's look at this here really quickly. Continuing the numbering exercise, number one, you have the milestone. Number two, you have the last sticky. And then as soon as you've entered in the activity and the needs, then as these needs are met or placed on here, you actually need to have the stickies as predecessors or as constraints or needs, meaning stickies in the sequence, placed on there ahead of that so that these two items can be checked. So you're moving backwards, but you're not moving backwards any farther or faster than you check off these items. And when you check off these items, that's how you know what tags or other stickies need to be added to the sequence. This is very, very important. And I hope you always remember this, because if you do this, you'll have a complete sequence as you go. Quite remarkable stuff. So let me go ahead and take you to the rest of this training. On page number 77 of the TAC planning book, you'll see that in the instructions, in this one, we went backwards to start and everything was pretty much listed as a finish to start. But then when you do your check word check in the opposite direction, you'll find what's called parallelization or concurrent activities. This is where it's natural. It's not going to hurt anybody. Basically, you're optimizing your time. When you're done with the pull plan, you'll have a complete pull plan. But I want to make a point about something. Your pull plan isn't by large batched areas. Your pull plan should be by one single zone. So this single zone right here is what you pull plan. So if this is the pull plan, that's great. But the pull plan before you even started, it was only for one representative zone. All the durations here were for that zone, and it simply represents one sequence in the TAC plan. Let me say this. A pull plan is simply a single sequence in a zone for a TAC plan, and a TAC plan is nothing more than multiple sequences for multiple zones based off of one single pull plan. And let me go ahead and draw a box around this. We don't batch the whole floor of the whole building. We simply do one representative zone. That's what creates the pull plan, and then that is then looped into your first sequence, and then when you copy it down zone by zone on the rhythm, on the stagger, that's what creates the actual TAC plan, which is then what creates the norm level TAC plan in its entirety. This is absolutely brilliant, because this is how production planning really works in the field, real life. One of the things that I do want to say is when you're doing the comparison, meaning that when you go through and you say, hey, I've packaged the pull plan into my wagon, 3-day TAC time, 3-day TAC time, 3-day TAC time, you'll find that when you copy the first wagon down to the second zone, the second wagon, you'll start to see that there's irregularities when it comes to rhythm and flow. And that's fine, but we have to take these steps, either listed briefly here or in more depth down here. You have to follow these steps to actually create more flow in the field. Let me talk about that right now. One thing we found here was these three separate activities needed to be adjusted into one crew. The fire sprinkler was originally at 2 days, and so that it could flow from area to area to area nice and beautifully, we had to adjust the labor counts. Sometimes you have to adjust the sequence. Sometimes you have to say, we don't have flow, so that contractor will have workable backlog work somewhere else on the project. Sometimes you have to pair an activity with another crew, but if you can't, if you truly have a one-off activity that doesn't have flow, and what I mean by flow is that you can do first day, second day, third day, then do first day, second day, third day, right? It doesn't have good flow in the diagonal, then you at least have to buy it out that way and make sure that the trade partner partner is whole from a financial standpoint. Because the bottom line at the end of all of this is that we really want to make sure that we have leveled trades, meaning we don't have a trade that's out of the rhythm. They're all leveled and having similar to the same duration. And we don't want to have zones that are just leveled or identified by square foot. We want to have them leveled by work density. And we also want to have the right number of zones, which is a part of the TAC planning process to begin with. And I do want to say, before we did this pull plan, as an example, the one that we're showing in the book, you'll go ahead and identify the right number of zones with the trade partners to start. Because if you don't, you'll batch large areas and lose time and you won't gain the buffers. And so by rezoning a project and having the right zone sizes, you'll be very, very successful. So I do want to mention that when you do that, you still have the same amount of time for the trades. It's simply that it's zoned properly, which is quite remarkable. So let me take you to this example from an overall standpoint and do a little bit of talking about what this looks like on an actual board. All right, so this is exciting, everybody. The first thing that you'll do when you're doing your pull planning, like I said, identify your conditions of satisfaction. You'll see here that we said pull to the start of drywall, keep it high level, accurate, find any missing activities. Step two, identify your start and finish milestone. On this one, we said, okay, reshore and removal, and then the finish milestone would be the start of drywall. So all good. Then we say, what is the sticky format? In this format, we're doing it on Miro. Let me go ahead and zoom in on here so you can see this a little bit better. We said duration, activity, needs. This is not the typical, I would say, pre-formatted sticky that sometimes people have printed, but this did work very well for us on Miro, so we did that, and we also identified the sticky colors. Then what you can see here, like we talked about before, is we created our method of doing work. And once that's done, you're ready to go ahead and start the pull plan. So this is our active area. And just like I told you in the instruction before, the first thing that we want to do is identify our proper zone size. And you'll do that with the actual trade partners themselves. And it's quite remarkable. So you can, I'm not going to take you through the video right now, but we have a calculator. All you do is go on to leantakt.com, and down at the bottom, you'll see the template, and you can actually use that template to identify the right number of zones. And so what we did and what we're showing you in this picture is that for this floor, we were able to identify that a good production target is at 11 zones. And so that's what we'll pull plan to. This will be what the durations are when we get this started. So quite remarkable stuff here. When we get started with the pull plan based on the right zone size, we will set up the area for our pull plan based on that zone size. And I've got two little examples here. These two right here are going to show you the difference between TAC time-based TAC planning and resource-based TAC planning. But what I want to first show you is what the actual pull plan would look like if you did this real life, like National Geographic style. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and zoom in here a bit, and let's see if you can see these activities. When you start, you'll first notice that everything in here is listed by day. So day one, day two, day three. And so if there's an activity like overhead sprinkler, you'll see that overhead sprinkler has actually three stickies, and this is very important to the overall pull plan attack system. So what we did is, and I have a video of this that we'll link you to in the description below. First sticky, remove reshore. Second, patch ceiling. Third, sweep floor. Okay, we're done. Who's the next trade partner? Then the GC would be like, okay, we need to refresh control lines. Then it's like, what's next? All right, layout walls. Then overhead fire sprinkler. It doesn't matter if you're doing this virtually, which I prefer, by the way. This format is what I prefer. It doesn't matter if the trade partner enters in their own sticky, handwrites their own sticky, or moves their own sticky. I'm the facilitator and I don't mind putting it up there, but they have to declare their own sticky. So what we'll do is we'll get a sequence going forward for this pull plan in one zone. Now, the reason I like to have it day by day, as you've seen here, is because then what I like to do when I'm doing a pull plan is take this sequence right here and copy it at my TAC time rhythm down here. And what that will enable us to do is I'll be able to say, okay, this is one crew, then we go down, then okay, they have good flow. Fire sprinkler, they go over, they down, all right, good flow. Refresh control lines, you guys don't have good flow, but that's the field engineer, so it's not a big deal. Hey, framer, you've got two activities, but there's a gap here in the middle, and I don't really like that for you. Is that a problem? They're like, no, we're working in another part of the job. It's not a big deal. And then I'm like, okay, mechanical duct, okay, you have good flow. So this is a way for us to look at it in a way that shows us whether or not we have good flow. Once you have that, and you've gotten all the way down to the end for your second sequence, so if I zoom room in here. You remember I said if you go forward, then you have to go back, or if you go back, then you have to go forward. So in this pull plan, we went forward. Now we have to go back. So what I want to show you is if you have something like one side drywall, you take the first activity in the sequence, and then you remember you have to have them come up with two needs. So this one said in-wall process piping and inspections. All right, well, do we have in-wall process piping? Yep. All right, so then you mark that a yes. All right, inspections. Oh, we didn't have inspections, so we'd better add this inspect wall sticky. Now we can check mark yes. And you just keep going back and back and back. So this one would, you would add needs here, you would add needs here, you would add needs here. You would keep going backwards to make sure that your trade partners had everything that they need. So this is just a representative example. And by the time you're done, you'll have a complete sequence. Let me go ahead and zoom out here just a little bit. What you would do in Miro, and this is why I like doing this on Miro electronically, is that once you're done, you would copy these down to the all 11 zones and then make sure that you hit your milestone. Now, one last thing before we're done, because I hope you've enjoyed this. When you're doing takt time-based takt planning, what you'll do is you will force everything into a takt time. So you really have to adjust crew counts. You really have to do some intentional thinking about how you want to package work, and everything will basically be looped into your takt time, which in this case is 3. But you don't have to do it that way, and let me go ahead and show that to you now. You can use a system called resource-based takt planning, and what resource-based takt planning will basically say is, hey, each of these activities can have their own rhythm. You see fire sprinkler, instead of crewing them down, they are on a 2-day rhythm. You'll see that priority walls on a 2-day rhythm, and we don't get to the 3-day takt time until we're over here to the mechanical. So there's two different ways that we can do that once you package everything together, but this is basically the overall system. And I really, really love doing it this way because you're always able to gain time and you're always able to make sure that you have a complete sequence, a production plan, and buffers at the end of the phase. And so what I'm going to do is we're going to link you to this book so that you know how to order it. We will link you to a Miro board for this pull planning so you can experiment, and we'll link you to an actual example of us doing pull planning so you can get started on it yourself. And my hope is that you're able to implement this right away. If you need us, give us a call. We do this all the time with clients on projects with remarkable results. I hope you've enjoyed this video. On we go.